Try to remember feeling better, but I can't at all. I keep waiting for a moment to catch my breath, slow down my mind. My heart is tired after all these years of running and running and running and running and running. So let's take some time and rest in the stillness.
Good afternoon, everybody. How's it going? Are you excited to be here this morning? Excited to sing some songs to the Lord? We're going to start with a new song this morning. Another new song. But I love new songs. The word says, sing a new song to the Lord. So let's all please stand together and give him praise. Lord, we do give you all the praise. All the glory is yours. For we know, Lord, that you are the only one worthy to receive our praise. This world is always looking for people to praise it. Things in this world things of this world. It's always crying out for the attention of our hearts. But Lord, we give you our attention this morning, and not only this morning, God, but we pray that you would capture our attention on a constant basis, that we wouldn't take the work of the cross for granted in any way. So again, Lord, we just want to say that we love you. God, we want to ask for your presence, for a fresh outpouring of your presence this morning. Thank you, God, that you fight our battles for us. In Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord is in the fight, and we know how this ends. It will end like it started, with him in command. The Lord is in the we'll be right back. God fights for us. Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus.
There's no one like a God.
Yeah.
my life. Sometimes we fail to be good to others, just like you were good to us. Lord, forgive us. And we're so glad that there's forgiveness in you, oh Lord. But God, continue to do a work here in this church. Revive us, oh Lord. Open our eyes, Lord, to the beauty of who you are and your word. And help us to be strong in this world for you, in Jesus' name. God's people say, Say hi to somebody next to you, please.
Good afternoon. How's everyone doing? This one's doing really good. Thank you for saying so. For those of you tuning in online, thanks again for joining us. We're blessed to have you here with us. And I know there's a group out on the patio, so thanks again for joining us. It's beautiful temperature out there right now. It's nice. We do have a few things we'd like to talk about this morning, a couple of announcements. And the first one is for you ladies. The women's hike is coming up this coming Saturday morning. The ladies will be headed out to Santa Rosa Plateau for a 4-mile hike. And there is a $4 entrance fee to go out on the plateau. So bring that with you. And if you'll go directly to our website, it'll tell you the specific location where they're going to start at. And again, that's at 8 a.m. sharp start. And then the next thing we want to talk about is a blood drive that we have coming up. And we're partnering with Livestream Blood Bank. And so we will be having a blood drive here on Sunday, the 27th. We'll be back in the gym. It'll be from 7 a.m. to 1 p.m. And you need to sign up ahead of time. And if you go to our app and click on weekly happenings or weekly ministries, there's a link to get signed up for there. And so we have an opportunity to give back, give blood to our local community here. We get to help save some lives. And then we have a rubbing sale coming up to help support our missionaries that are in Bulgaria. If you haven't met the Laster family, they've been in Bulgaria for several years, and they're doing a little fundraiser. And so starting on June the 20th from 8 to 12 on the lower campus, we will be collecting gently used items that they'll be able to sell at the rummage sale. And so then we'll give you a little more information. I believe on the 27th, we'll have that rummage sale. And so it could be the 26th, I forget which day. We'll give you more details. But if you could donate your things and then come back and buy them at an extremely high price, we would greatly appreciate that. Isn't that a good idea, Brian? Yeah. So, no, really, it's a great opportunity for us to help support them and keep them in the mission field. And then we do have a couple things going on here. We have some job openings here at church, and so we're looking to fill those. If you are interested in that, if you'll go directly to our website, it says not on our app. I know we send you to our app a lot, but this is on our website. If you go directly to our website, it'll say job opportunities. It's a kind of a gray area on our website, gray box. And we have a couple of positions that we would like to talk about, and that is we need some ministry support here. So there's some things that we need to support our ministries here. So there's a position there, as well as an audiovisual tech. And so if you have those skills and you'd like to join us, please apply. We'd love to have you join our team. Thanks.
Thanks, my brother. Good afternoon. What a great church. We just want your blood, all of your stuff, and then come back and buy your stuff. That's awesome. We're not afraid. Oh, boy. Hey, we have an Israel trip coming up. And matter of fact, right after this service at 1:30, we're going to meet and do an informational meeting right over in the Agape room. And like what Chuck Smith always said, it's worth about 2 years of Bible study. And it really is. You cram everything in 2 weeks, and so it'll be a 14-day trip. And with that, I worked in for the first time in a long time a couple of free days, one up on the Sea of Galilee, one down in Jerusalem. And there's still a ton of stuff to do, but literally from breakfast to dinner, you're on the run. I mean, there's a lot to take in, even driving on the bus. Our guide, his name is Guy, so Guy, our guide. These guys are so educated within, obviously, in Judaism, in Islam, in Christianity, in all the different wars, in flora and fauna, and I mean, it just goes on and on. These guys are just a plethora of wisdom, and so with that, we just have a blast hanging out with each other for a couple weeks, and so if you want more details, we'll have that meeting right after this service. And then tonight, from 6:30 to 7:30, we have our night of prayer, and so it's for an hour. Again, same room over in the Agape room, and which is right next to our front office, and we'd love for you to join us. Even if you're nervous at all about maybe you haven't been in a kind of a public prayer meeting before, you don't have to pray. I mean, we want you to pray, but you can pray silently. You don't have to. It's not one of those ones where you're in a circle and somebody squeezes your hand and now all the pressure's on you to be able to pray. So we don't do that. And so with that, if you can just come out, agree with us in prayer. But with it, we think you would enjoy that time. And an hour sounds like a long time, but it goes by pretty fast. And we'll just pray through different topics. So tonight at 6:30. I'm going to pray, and we're going to be in Exodus 12, finishing up that that chapter. Father, we come before you. I think of the different songs that we just sang that just puts all of our focus and attention upon you. Everything in our world has become such a distraction from you, as we get so busy and occupied of our little sandcastles down here on earth. And we forget about oftentimes what it's all about, that you continue to people eternity, and that ultimately one day we're going to be with you forever and to be able to feast and dine and just enjoy hearing from you, learning of you for all of our eternity forward. And so, Lord, we just thank you as we can pause on this Sunday morning to be able to come together with our brothers and sisters and to be able to worship you in song, be able to worship you in your word, and, of course, this morning to be able to worship you in our communion time. And so we look forward to what you want to share with us. In Jesus' name, amen. As I said, I've entitled it The Walk of Freedom. When we think of freedom, well, let me say this about remembrance. Remembrance plays a powerful role in our spiritual journey. You know, all of us have things where we shouldn't go back in our past and remember them. they're damaging to us, maybe emotionally, maybe it was something hard that had taken place and it just hurts our souls in a deep way. There's some things we don't want to remember. But there's other things God is constantly calling us to remember. And that's, of course, what we're talking about. So remembrance plays a powerful role in our spiritual journey. If we regularly remember and commemorate our own spiritual deliverance, the day you got saved, we'll relish the freedom in which we now walk. And so with that, it's good to pause and think back. Who was talking with me when I got saved? Who was sharing Jesus with me? Who was praying for my soul? That might have been mom or grandma or somebody that was praying for you, but in thinking those through, it's good to remember back. The walk of freedom. Our country has the Freedom Trail. If you've ever been back to Boston and walked the Freedom Trail, it's a great thing to be able to do and remember what happened at each of the different sites there. Today we commemorate D-Day, where the Battle of Normandy resulted in the Allied liberation, we're talking about freedom, the Allied liberation of Western Europe from Nazi Germany's control. Nelson Mandela came out with an autobiography, and it was called Long Walk to Freedom. Our church participates each year in A21's anti-human trafficking group that do a walk of freedom over in Temecula. And here in Exodus chapter 12, we'll remember the beginning of Israel's walk of freedom. We call this the book of Exodus. Today is the place where the Exodus starts. They actually exit, and we'll read that in just a minute. But the study of the Passover, as we talked about it last Sunday, we're wrapping up with it today. Today we do, first Sunday of the month, we do communion, and so I thought it'd be a great, I didn't want to finish it all up there. I wanted to tie it in here because what I wanted to do for us, a lot of times we have the Lord's Supper, we do communion, and it feels like it's sometimes just tacked on the end of a message. And what I wanted to do is instead build all the way up to it, making that the highlight. But we're going to move from Passover all the way up to Lord's Supper and notice the connections, notice the contrasts, and we'll see that the one connects with the other. To fully live for our deliverer, we must always remember our deliverance. So we're going to study the Passover. It's going to enrich our understanding of the Lord's Supper. And so let me pause and say, did you get a communion on the way in? Does everybody have one? If not, we'll have one of the ushers bring you one. If you want to raise your hand, we'll get you one. Everybody have that? Okay. We need a couple in here. That'd be awesome if one of our ushers, hello, ushers in the foyer, can you hear me? All right. Very good. On this side over here, we got a couple hands raised. If you guys just leave them up, we got one right up front, another one in the back. Awesome. While you guys just keep your hands up, Chris will make sure he gets you one of those. So, my daughter sent me a meme. It said, we'll know COVID is over when we're no longer having Robitussin and Styrofoam for our communion elements. So, these aren't my favorite, but praise God, they're clean and safe, and we'll continue to use those for a time. All right. We're going to be looking at Exodus chapter 12. We're picking up in verse 29, and I'm going to read that through. So, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to move pretty fast through this last half of chapter 12, and with it, we'll take little chunks at a time. Just going to walk through it. Some of it is redundant from what we talked about last Sunday. Some of it will be a recap for us, and so I'm going to read 29 through 32. We're looking at Pharaoh's surrender. We're at the 10th plague. This is the death of the firstborn. Remember that what God has been doing is trying to attract, as he does with anybody, attract Pharaoh, the Egyptians, and the Hebrews to himself, showing himself as, I'm the one and true and living God. And so what he did is each one of the plagues got a little bit worse. Now we're up to the worst, number 10, and it is the death of the firstborn. At midnight, the Lord struck down all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon and all the firstborn of the livestock. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where someone was not dead. Then he summoned Moses and Aaron by night and said, up, go out from among my people, both you and the people of Israel, and go and serve the Lord. As you have said, take your flocks and your herds, as you have said, and be gone, and bless me also. That doesn't say much about this bless me also. Wonder what's going on in Pharaoh's heart. I don't think he gets born again at this place, right? But something's happening. I don't want those plagues anymore. Had enough of the 10 plagues. Maybe there's this awareness that this is a pretty strong God. And he flips it and says, one of the last things he says there is, would you bless me? Would you have him bless me? Now we know he counters and a little bit later is going to attack them at the Red Sea, right? But so it's not a changed life, but something's there of at least asking for the blessing. What we have here in verse 29 is, and I put it behind me, a vivid reminder of the fury of God against sinners and the awful price that sin exacts. The death of the firstborn here. Interesting that only one verse in all of Scripture, one verse is given over to this. See, the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, right? The Torah spends several verses talking about the Passover sacrifice. I mean, there's been a long chapter in talking about it. But only one verse on the killing of the firstborn. Maybe the 10th plague is just too painful to relate. They don't want to talk about it. It's hard for them. Realizing, too, that the Egyptians also are God's creatures here. They're seen as the enemy as we go through this story, but still made in the image of God. And many of the firstborn are innocents, the younger ones. It's amazing that, the Jews came up with, they found 613 laws in those first five books of our Bible. 613 laws. But did you know that one of them is a prohibition against hating Egyptians? It'll come out later in Deuteronomy 23:7. That's where it's found. But that they're not allowed to hate Egyptians. That's a fascinating thing. That's an interesting thing. Especially after this 10th plague here of God stepping in and doing this here. But we have to remember that. You and I have to remember that. It was a few years back, Kelly and I, with a group from the church here over in Cambodia, in Svipak. It was known as the pedophile capital of the world. And this ministry that's working there, AIM, and as they were showing us around and things, and with that, you're hearing story after story of the girls that have been rescued and how they're doing so well and accepted Christ. And now they're seeking to save other girls out of that life and what has taken place. But the common denominator is that in each case there's a pimp, whether it's mom, whether it's grandma, whether it's whoever else. But they're the bad guys of the story, and if hearing that, pretty soon they're monsters. Pretty soon you're just wanting they just need to be shot, and you're thinking of all these different things. And as they're walking us through the tour, they said, "And there's the Lord's gym." What do you mean the Lord's gym? Yeah, it's a workout facility across the street we built. We specifically did it for all the pimps. I said, really? And they said, yeah, we actually have number two and number three, the Muay Thai fighters there in Thailand, in Cambodia. And these guys are awesome, and the guys will look up to them. And it attracts a lot of the pimps that'll come in there. And they have Bible studies in there now. They've led a number of them to Christ. And it's kind of like in my spiritual, of course, it's like, yeah, of course that's what we would do. No, I was just killing them a few minutes ago in my mind. They all deserve to die and everything else. And just that reminder is, oh, no, we love them too. They're just broken in a different way. And it's just like, oh, yeah, I need to remember that as a pastor. Wow. Finally, Pharaoh comes to the point, verse 31, and says, go serve the Lord. He's heard. He heard through all these different ones. Moses kept saying that, but I was wondering, was he really hearing it? But this whole thing of them leaving was about going to serve the Lord, having that freedom of religion to be able to serve the one true and living God. Go and serve the Lord. That's the real issue. And it reminds us of the centrality of corporate worship, the importance of worshippers gathering all together to be able to worship, because so far he had said, okay, you can go, you just can't take your children with you. And then he says, not good enough. Okay, you can go and take your children, but you can't take your livestock. And so Pharaoh just kept playing this game, but there's this aspect of corporate worship that is so important here. And this past year, we've experienced the importance of corporate worship during the time of our pandemic, right? We can get by with online worship for a time, but eventually the lack of face-to-face worship destroys the sense of continuity of our historical community, this coming together. It was said that Voltaire said this, if you want to destroy Christianity, you must abolish Sunday. And it sure seemed in the early months when we would sit every other day as a board and trying to figure out what's going to happen. Do we even have a church? Is the church ever going to come back? Will we ever meet again? How many months or years is this going to go out? And what's a church going to look like on the other side? And just talking about fears and anxieties and angst. And what do we do? I'm going to speak to our cameras for a minute for our online friends and talk with them about this specific thing. We miss you, and we miss your spiritual gifts here at Calvary Murrieta. Because what we find as we step into the body of Christ, we realize that God has gifted us all very uniquely. We're like a giant puzzle, and all of our pieces are just a little bit unique and a little different. We all fit in somewhere. Matter of fact, Paul says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 16, he said this, that every part, each of us plays a part, each part does its share, and he makes the whole body fit together perfectly. Told you, sounds like a puzzle, huh? As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. See, a lot of times we stay away from church or decide not to come to church because we're thinking, I don't need it. I'm doing pretty good spiritually and see you next Sunday. But what you forget is that we need you. And that's my reminder. We need each other. And those that have decided to stay at home, let me say this. If sick in any way, health reasons in any way, please stay home. You need to. That's awesome. We fully 100% understand that. But there's a lot of my friends that I've talked to. We've just kind of gotten lazy over the last year. It's kind of nice just being able to pause you when I want to. Hey, wait a minute. You know what? Come on. But with that, I know something where I was really missing was that aspect of us singing together. I can't sing out loud in my house with just me or me and Kelly. That seems awkward to me. That's strange. And so coming back, even those times where we were just doing the recording here with just the five of us or just the worship team and those that were recording and stuff. And with that, I just felt so spoiled because I got to sit here all by myself in the sanctuary, but I had a whole band to worship you with, you know, and to be able to do that, it was hard. And so to our friends still at home, come back. We miss you. We miss you. Let's go on to the next part. Reparation for slavery. There we go. 33 through 36. The Egyptians were urgent with the people to send them out of the land in haste, for they said, we shall all be dead. They just thought, oh my gosh, this angel of death came flying through, killed our firstborn. Maybe they're coming back tonight after us. And so they just want these guys out of there. Verse 34. So the people took their dough before it was leavened, their kneading bowls being bound up and their cloaks on their shoulders. The people of Israel had also done as Moses told them, for they had asked the Egyptians for silver and gold jewelry and for clothing. And the Lord had given the people favor in the sight of the Egyptians so that they let them have what they asked. Thus they plundered the Egyptians. I don't have a whole lot to say about this reparations for their slavery. Reparations means making amends for a wrong one is done. That seems to be what's happening here. So maybe this silver and gold and nice clothes and the other things that they took from the Egyptians there are the reparations here. This is their wages for 400 plus years of slavery, and it's a little token of something to be able to leave the land with. Road trip, verse 37. Here's where the Exodus starts. And the people of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth. Ramses is another name for Goshen. They're at the delta of the Nile River right there, and that's where they grew up. So that's Ramses to Succoth. What that next word, though, we've never found. So we don't think it's maybe not even a city. Matter of fact, if you have a Jewish background, you would know that one of the feast days is Sukkot, or the Feast of Tabernacles, the Feast of Setting Up Tents, the Feast of Spending a Week Outside Under the Stars to remember back to this day. And so with that, Succoth means tents. So maybe it's the leaving of Goshen where they were, or Ramses, and they're out in the wilderness now, and it looks like a giant tent city. They're stopping for the night, and that's the place. So it's really not an exact location, but where they are out in the wilderness there. About 600,000 men on foot, besides women and children, so we're thinking maybe 2 million overall, a mixed multitude, so other foreigners that were living there in the land, possibly even some of the Egyptians following with them or taking off with them, a mixed multitude, also went up with them, and very much livestock, both flocks and herds. And they baked unleavened cakes of the dough that they had brought out of Egypt, for it was not leavened because they were thrust out of Egypt and could not wait, nor had they prepared any provisions for themselves. So the unleavened bread here is different from the beginning of the chapter. They did unleavened bread for Passover, but they've already actually had Passover. Then the angel of the death comes over right at midnight, and now they're leaving sometime between midnight and morning when they're taking off. So they're leaving in haste, and so that's why they don't have time to wait for their bread to rise. It's run. Verse 40 gives us a timing. The time that the people of Israel lived in Egypt was 430 years. At the end of 430 years, on that very day, that's an important point, at the end of, on that very day, all the hosts of the Lord went out from the land of Egypt. It was a night of watching by the Lord to bring them out of the land of Egypt. And so the same night is a night of watching kept to the Lord by all the people of Israel throughout their generations. A night of watching, a night to set up vigil, first by God and then by the people. First by God and watching over them. This is time for the Exodus. It is going to happen because he's watching over them. But then also by them, they're watching. They don't know what Pharaoh's going to do. Is he going to change his mind again? We know he's going to in the future when he meets him at the Red Sea. But with the midst of that, extreme watchfulness is taking place here. When the Jews celebrate their Seder feast, this Passover, when they're doing that, they'll do two things, showing their watchfulness. They'll leave the front door open, and they'll set a extra place setting at the table for Elijah, because it says towards the end of the Old Testament that before Messiah comes, that Elijah is going to show up. Now, we know that now as part of his second coming, before his second coming. And with that, Jesus even said, if you've seen John the Baptist, he's like a type of Elijah that's already come, and explain all that. But today, there's a calling on you and I to be watchful also, watchful for a second return. I like as Paul's wrapping up 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 13, and he specifically tells us, be watchful. There's actually a few more statements. He says, be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong, let all that you do be done in love. It's a great, like, as he's wrapping up the whole thing, it's just like, yeah, go get them, you know. But be watchful. Gregorio is actually in the Greek, Gregorio. So if your name is Greg or Gregory, that's what your name means, right? To be alert, to be watchful. And it's a reminder when we call somebody Gregory or whatever else, let it be a reminder to our minds that we are to be watchful even still today. Let's cover a couple of lessons so far. Though we move ahead into freedom, we are never to forget what God has done in the past. Great reminder for us. The second one, would you define your life today as slavery or freedom, Egypt or promised land? Where are you at in your Christianity? Third one, never forget, always remember, and dream forward. That seems to be a common theme through this. Number four, live in a perpetual state of readiness to respond to God's special call on our lives. And the last one there, are you willing and ready to move from the familiar to the unfamiliar? Whew, that's hard. 430 years, that means generation after generation after generation after generation, probably after generation at least, that many generations, this is all they know. They've never been in the promised land. They haven't grown up there. This is what they know. They know the Egyptian landscape. They know the Egyptian way of life. They know the delta of the Nile River there. They know Goshen. That's about it. And a whole lot of slavery, a whole lot of slave work during that time. That's what they know. That's what they're familiar with. And you know, a little bit later on in the wilderness, they're going to complain about, wait, didn't we have it better back there? That's hard. It's hard to change from the familiar to the unfamiliar, to the unknown, to the what's next. That's hard for us. As you do it, maybe did it, maybe at the place in college years where all of a sudden you're going, I think I'm going to change my major. We're talking about, you know, we have a number of friends moving out of state. It's moving from the familiar to the unfamiliar. And that's hard, whether it's moving across town or to a different state or whatever it is. Those are hard decisions. But are you willing and ready if God wants to move you, whether it's a physical location or doing something different in your life? Are you ready as they were ready? We wrap up this chapter with this, and then I'm going to jump to talk about another chapter in the New Testament. Passover revisited from 43 through 51, and it Again, this is, it's going to sound like the Passover hasn't happened, but it already has happened. So it's a little bit redundant, but it's adding who's ineligible to eat the Passover. It'll be for later on. And the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, this is the statute of the Passover. No foreigner shall eat of it. Remember, they just told us a mixed multitude went out with them. And so it's kind of setting up just a few more things. No foreigner shall eat of it, but every slave that is bought for money may eat of it after you have circumcised him. No foreigner or hired worker may eat of it. It shall be eaten in one house. You shall not take any of the flesh outside the house, and you shall not break any of its bones. Pause. That's that scripture that reminds us why Jesus' legs weren't broken. Just like the other two thieves when he was on the cross, it's because of the prophecy that was here for the Passover lamb. And he is becoming our Passover, you know, New Testament becomes our Passover lamb. And that's where that comes from right there. Verse 47, all the congregation of Israel shall keep it, the Passover. If a stranger shall sojourn with you and would keep the Passover to the Lord, let all his males be circumcised, right? That was saying you're part of us. You're one of us. It was that symbol to be able to say that you're doing it. So you can't just enjoy the Passover meal. No, you got to be all in. Then he may come near and keep it. He shall be as a native of the land, but no uncircumcised person shall eat of it. There shall be one law for the native and for the stranger who sojourns among you. All the people of Israel did just as the Lord commanded Moses and Aaron. And on that very day, the Lord brought the people of Israel out of the land of Egypt by their hosts. When we jump to the New Testament and meet John the Baptist, and he's walking with a couple of his disciples, he's kind of like a rabbi to the guys that are following him. And he says, behold, the Lamb of God. Says it two different times. Says that under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. I think what he was saying when he said, behold, the Lamb of God, I think he was saying, I get it now. I get it. Our firstborn were saved, speaking about his, you know, the guys back here at the original Passover. Our firstborn were saved because God gave us his firstborn. I get it now. He's that Passover lamb. Now I'm understanding why. It was the answer to Abraham, what God basically said. See, Abraham was supposed to take that knife and slay his only son to test his faith. We read from Hebrews that the reason he's able to do this, they didn't believe in child sacrifice, right? But with that, this faith, believing that even that God could raise him from the dead, I will be faithful to my God to do anything he asks me to, because even in the taking of my son's life, maybe he's going to raise him from the dead. I don't know, but I'm going to be faithful to it. But what happened when he was doing it? All of a sudden, stop, don't do it, right? The angel shows up and says, don't slay your son. It stops him from doing that. It was just testing of his faith. But this seemed to be in the answer to Abraham, where God basically said, I'm going to walk up the mountain with my son and place the wood on him, except there'll be no one to tell me to stop. I have to go through with it. For all the world, I have to go through with it with my son. One commentator put it this way. When the ultimate child cried, my God, why are you forsaken me? The father paid the price in his silence. So when John said, behold the Lamb of God, he wasn't saying, there he is. I mean, he's pointing him out for sure. But he's saying that word behold packs a lot. He's saying, behold, think about it. Take it in. Realize it. Look. Grasp what's actually taking place. Who is standing in front of us here, the Passover Lamb. You know, There's four chapters in the Bible where Abraham's chapter about the lamb is there's a debt. A debt needs to be paid, a sacrifice. In Moses' chapter that we've just read of the lamb is what a substitute could pay for that debt. And that's what we learn in the Passover lamb. And then the third one, Jesus' chapter on the lamb, is hidden showing up in the New Testament saying, it's me, God's only son at the Lord's Supper. And there's one more chapter to come where the Lamb is on the throne, and that's in Revelation chapter 7, verse 17. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, which is an interesting kind of double metaphor there. He's both our Lamb and our shepherd. And he will guide them to the springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. That he's going to bring you salvation with that living water, but he's also going to be able to, he cares about us emotionally and what we're going through and wipe away our tears because he knows our pain. Here's where I'm going to hop, skip, and jump to the New Testament, to Luke's account with the Last Supper in Luke chapter 22, 14 through 20. Some commentators say that what Jesus was doing at the Lord's Supper wasn't an official Passover meal because in all four Gospels, it doesn't talk about the lamb being on the table. Well, I say it absolutely has to be, especially, and that's why I picked Luke's account here, because in verse 8 through 13, he uses the word Passover about four or five times, so he's saying it's the Passover. Go prepare the Passover meal. Here's where you're going to prepare the Passover meal, what to bring, what to get, where to go, who to follow, the guy with the water pot, follow him at this time of day. He'll lead you to the place where I want you to have it, get it all set up. So it's all the prep for a Passover meal. But as the Passover sacrifice, the focal point was the lamb on the table. But for the Lord's Supper, it's the lamb not on the table. We don't even hear of it, like I said, but it's the lamb at the table. It's Jesus himself kind of taking that place now of that Passover lamb. As Israel looked back to the Exodus through the Passover meal, so we, the New Testament saints, look back to the cross and the resurrection through the Lord's Supper. In the Passover, the Jews remember and proclaim their redemption from Egypt. In the Lord's Supper, believers remember and proclaim our redemption from sin. It's kind of a new Exodus. Exodus from the world, exodus from our flesh, exodus from the evil one himself. Let me read it. So we pick up in Luke 22:14. And when the hour came, he reclined at the table and the apostles with him. And he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. And he's going to do this twice. He's going to look out into the future. This is the first time. For I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Now, he ate the Passover feast with them, but what he's saying is, I'm not going to ever eat this again until you're with me in the kingdom in the future. Verse 17, and he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, so after this, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. I'm going to fast from eating, I'm going to fast from drinking. Can't wait to do it again with you one day up in heaven. Verse 19, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to them saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. At the Passover was the day of remembrance. Here we have, do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, the cup after they had eaten saying, this cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. So basically, Luke's covering four things here. First, this whole Lord's Supper, we're sitting at a Passover feast, but it's changing. And so that's why I called it the Passover passed over. It's rooted in redemption, number one. It brings our minds all the way back and should with us also all the way back to the Passover, from slavery to freedom. That's what we need to remember. When we think of the Passover, it went from slavery to freedom, and it reminds us we went from slavery to ourselves, to our flesh, to the world, to the devil, to the freedom that the Lord gives us. Secondly, the Lord's Supper is planned by Jesus. Meticulous planning. As I mentioned from verse 8 through 13 that I didn't read, but you can go back and read that. It's planned by Jesus. He's doing this. And he loves to meet you at the communion table. Let me give you a little bit of what he says. He says in verse 15, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. That earnestly desired. Do you know what it means? Take the most extreme ability of lust, and that's what it is. Now, you and I, we hear that word lust, and we kind of cringe by it. It's always in the negative, but he so radically, to the depth of his emotions, wanted to do this and couldn't wait. That's what he says when he was eating with these guys, and feels just as passionate for the one out for the meal out in the future that we're going to have. But I want to say, Calvary Murrieta, it's today also that he has that much same passion for us when we do this. That it's something more than, oh yeah, it's time for communion again. Let's pop open the bread and pop open the cup. Now, it might feel that for us from some day. I'm simply saying for him, that's not the way he's seeing it. He rejoices at your presence. Thirdly, it anticipates the future. There's this promise of a feast that will be fulfilled later but starts now. This little fragment of a bread and this little sippy cup that we have, what is that? As we're looking at that, but I want you to frame it a whole different way. If you look at it as the first course, or I was just at a couple of weddings lately that I was a part of, and with that, when it's all done, it's food time, and as we go and we stand in there with a bunch of people and people walking around and giving us a little kind of snacky. But that doesn't, that's like, well, this is all we're going to eat. No, it's just the snacky, right? Before the main event, right? Before you get to sit down and grind on whatever we're going to eat, right? And that's what he's saying to us. This is going to be a remembrance. It's a little piece of bread. It's a little sip of the cup. But it's to remind you out to the future. So we've already looked back. Now we're going to look forward to one day having one of the most incredible feasts together. I love that Jesus is a foodie like me. He loves food. I love food. Do any of you love food? I love food. We're wired to love food. It's going to be an awesome thing. And so with that, this is just kind of first course, if that. It's barely a course, but it's something to remind us of what's to come. At its source in northern Minnesota, the Mississippi River is an unimpressive little stream that you can easily wade in. But even at that point, it is the real thing. You call it the Mississippi River. You're standing in the Mississippi River. And it's like with the bread and the cup. It's really it. Yes, it'll be fulfilled later, but it starts now. And that is that step towards what one day we're going to so enjoy with him. Fourth, it recalls Jesus' substitutionary death. As he's talking to the guys at the table, he says, "This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." That's the emphasis here, that he is the redeemer. He is the redemption. It's about him. And then it says, given for you, which speaks to his unique and once for all, fully sufficient substitutionary death. It's beautiful. So it is interesting in all four Gospels, we don't hear anything of the Passover lamb being on the table. I believe it was because they're having Passover and that's what you had. That was all about that. But instead, he uses the bread and the wine, and that's what he talks about at the feast. I'm going to bring out two different symbols as we have our wedding ring for a symbol. We have a United States flag as our symbol of our country, and so we have these different symbols. Let me give you two more symbols is what he's doing here. But here's why he doesn't, because shouldn't we say, why didn't he just use the lamb on the table? If that's the main event, it's like turkey at Thanksgiving, right? It's the main thing. But he doesn't use that, and here's why. And I don't think I've ever seen this before, so I thought it was pretty great, is because Passover, original Passover, is about a sacrifice. The Lord's Supper is about a feast. He's moving this meal. Now, can you still celebrate that if you're Jewish? Sure. Or even if we as non-Jewish, you know, enjoy the Seder feast and we can learn a lot from it, I think they're great in all of that. Let's remember back what God did for them at the time of Passover. But what he's saying here, it's not a sacrifice. That's not what communion is. He was the sacrifice. He's been sacrificed. And so what it is, it's to point forward to that feast day. That's the reminder of what that, I can't wait to be with you and eat together and drink together. That's what he says, and that's what we're reminded of. And it's interesting, as I saw that, is that's the point. That's why he didn't use the lamb on the table. 1 Corinthians 5, 7 and 8. For indeed Christ, our Passover. So it just comes out and just says it. Paul makes it so clear. For indeed, Christ our Passover was sacrificed for us. There's our sacrifice word. Therefore, let us keep the feast, he says, not with old leaven, not with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Bread goes back to feast and bread. That's the point. No longer sacrifice. He's already done the sacrifice. Okay, let me wrap up with just a couple things. Remembrance. Normally we celebrate, you and I, we celebrate somebody's birthday, not their death day. Death days are hard to celebrate. My mom, when I was 21 years old, she died, and it's a week from this Wednesday. It's a death date. And with that, Jesus is more concerned, not that you celebrate my birthday, though we like doing that at Christmas time. It's about his death day. That's what I want you to commemorate. That's what I want you to remember. What I did, how I died, what it was for, how you know, what you gained from it. And so with that, he says to remember. Remember that he was a good man, a good Savior, a loving friend, a living hope, and a coming Lord. How does the Lord's Supper help us to be able to remember him? You know, it causes us to pause for a moment in our pilgrimage. And we're going to have that time when we take the bread. We're just going to pause. And it gives us a graphic picture of salvation to reminds us how bad my sin was, that he would have to die for it. It reminds us of the reassuring promise of his grace. And it remains clear prophecy of the future and what is coming. So this morning, if you haven't trusted God as your Lord and Savior, trust God's Passover sacrifice for you, Jesus himself. So you'll be passed over from judgment and say, Jesus, will you please be my Passover lamb? And receive him in faith and have an attitude of surrender and repentance. And you're welcome to join him at his communion table. He says, come. At this time, we're going to move to our last thing, our communion. So I'll invite up Romolo and the team, and we'll partake in communion. But if you will, if you can take off the top cellophane and to be able to get the bread out. Paul, when he was reminding us about communion, partaking in that, he said one thing to us, very important at this point of our time, is to examine yourself. What do I need to confess before my God? Oh, I've been forgiven of my sins when I got saved, but we continue to sin, and so with that, we don't want to break fellowship with him, and that's what really our sin does. It doesn't kick us out of his family. We're still his son or his daughter, but it breaks that fellowship with him, and that's why we analyze those things and say, what do I need to confess that I did, that I thought, words I spoke to somebody, and we think those through. That's not proper English behind me there, but I like that phrase, can you be more bad than God is good? That's deep. Can you be more bad? Like, is there something that you can't confess? Something that you think is so horrific that God could never forgive you of that? No way. You can only sin as a man, but God forgives as God. And you sin as a finite creature, but he forgives you as an infinite creator. Confess your sin to him. As Jeremiah said, for I will forgive their iniquity and their sin. I will remember no more. Put in the top part of the screen there, I just saw this. I thought this was pretty great. Bread broken is Christ for us. Bread eaten is Christ in us. And bread partaken together is Christ among us. And so we do this as a corporate body, as we talked about earlier, coming together and participating together. So Lord, we hold this bread in our hands as a symbol, as a sign, and to take our minds and go backwards first and remember what you did for us on that cross, not only dying for us, but just as you promised, rose from the dead. God, it also takes our mind out into the future of one day sitting and eating with you, and we look forward to that. So Lord, as we pause and confess our sins, we're once again asking you for the forgiveness of those sins. Let's do that now. Father, thank you for sending your son to die for us. Jesus, thank you for going to the cross for me and my sins. And thank you for washing our sins away. Thank you for that cleansing, this power in the blood. Thank you, God. And so, Lord, we partake in this bread together, remembering you this afternoon. Let's partake together. the cup. Passover requires 4 cups of wine, still to this day. They drink 2 before the meal. They drink 2 after the meal. Each of them are symbolic. They actually each come from Exodus chapter 6, verse 6 and 7, where it's not that the cups are named, but what they represent are. The first one is the cup of sanctification, that you're holy, you're set apart from the rest of this world. The second one is the cup of rescue or deliverance, as they think back to the Passover. The third cup is the cup of redemption. That's the one Jesus is going to toast to them here. The fourth is the cup of praise, which he won't drink until we're together with him. And so these 4 expressions of deliverance that is talked about there. And this is when Jesus established the new covenant in his own blood, was with that cup specifically of redemption. And as we think of that he gave thanks, and I put this quote behind me, I thought it was good. Thanksgiving is the expression of joy Godward. He loves when we have thankful hearts. We all have something to gripe about. We do every single day. But as we train ourselves to have an attitude of gratitude, right, and thinking of thanksgiving, believers are encouraged to abound in thanksgiving. And so let's do that now. Lord, we take this cup. It is the cup of redemption. It's the cup of thanksgiving that we just thank you, Lord, for all that you have done, continue to do, and promise to do for us in the future. And so, Lord, we give you thanks for everything, especially that blood shed for us. Thank you for your forgiveness. Thank you for not giving up on us. Thank you for your great grace. Let's partake in the cup together. Thank you, God. Amen. Let's all stand for our final song together.
Just
Hey, I am glad we can get together and celebrate communion together. What a blessing it is to be able to get together with our brothers and sisters and to be able to do the very thing that he asked us to do. And so it's beautiful. Enjoyed the morning with you. God bless you. Have a wonderful Sunday. And you know, one of the things that we do, how we wrap up our whole Israel trip, is having communion in the garden where Jesus rose from the dead. So just saying. All right. God bless you guys.